How many of you have all of the details worked out for lunch or dinner tomorrow? Only a couple. How many of you have family with you tonight and you had dinner tonight and didn't actually have all the details worked out before dinner? Don't raise your hands. It's okay. And you know what? Your guests probably didn't have a clue that all the details weren't worked out, and it's okay. But we're so worried about getting everything right, getting everything in order, having everything turn out perfect, right? It's all about the details, getting the dressing right, or the stuffing right, or the ham, or the turkey, or the mashed potatoes, or mashed cauliflower. Please don't tell me you have mashed cauliflower on Christmas. It's just wrong, it's not right. Mashed potatoes on Christmas. But the details are important, right? We worry and we stress and we take time to make sure that every last detail is right and everything's in its place. It's just like this story that we read, right? Of the birth of Jesus from the Gospel of Luke. And as I read it to you, you probably saw in your head, if you weren't looking at the scene up here, and you pictured in your mind as I read the story, the things that you know are there in the story. And what did you see? What did you see in the story? As I read the story, what did you see?
A baby.
A baby. That's good. There was a baby. What else? What else did we see in this story as we read it?
Mary
and Joseph. What else?
Angels.
Shepherds.
Animals.
What? Sheep. What else? Anything else? A manger, right? The baby was lying in the manger. What else? Is there anything else? I heard wise men, a bright light. Somebody, please need to be over here. Was there wise men there? See, we see this scene up here, and those of you that can't see it, this is the normal scene we have for a manger scene, right? It's got Mary, Joseph, and the baby, and the shepherds, and there's animals, and there's wise men. But here's the kicker on the wise men. The wise men aren't actually in the Gospel of Luke. They're only in the Gospel of Matthew. And the wise men did what to get to Jesus? They followed the star. When did the star come?
The night
Jesus was born. Thank you, person who heard the sermon last hour. Right. The wise men could not have been in the manger scene because they followed the star that appeared the night that Jesus was born. And they came from afar. Right? Not a fire. Afar. They came from a long way away. Right? The wise men weren't there. That doesn't mean it's wrong if you have them in your manger scene. It's okay. It all works, right? Because this is the story that we know. Actually, if you read the story in Luke, if we reread it and listen to it real close, you'll notice that it doesn't say anything about any animals being there either. There's no animals in the manger. What about the innkeeper that told them there's no room? There's no innkeeper in the story either. Right? These are all details that we know from a story. Kind of like candy cane. It's a very wonderful story. But it's not true. We're missing the details of the story. We're missing the deep down meaning of what is actually trying to be told here. As I read this story this past week, and I prepared for this lesson, and I read this story that I've now read for 8 years as an ordained minister and preached on Christmas Eve, because this is the same text that's always been the whole time I've been ordained and will be for all probably eternity the whole time that I'm ordained, and beyond that, the text that we read on Christmas Eve, Luke chapter 2, verses 1 through 20, because it is the story that we get of Jesus in the manger. And as we read this story over and over again, hopefully some things hit us. And as I read it this week, something hit me. In those days, the decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all of the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. Of all times I've read this, the first two verses stick out to me this week. Why? It's interesting to think about this for a moment. Historically, this registration is found nowhere else. There was a registration around the time of Jesus' birth, but it was probably when Jesus was about 10, It was a few years after King Herod had passed away, and King Herod, we know from the Gospel of Matthew, is the king that sent the wise men on to Bethlehem, right? The wise men come to King Herod first and say, where's the star? We saw the star of the Christ that we were looking for. And then, when the wise men don't come back, knowing that the star had risen 2 years ago, King Herod had all male children, two and under, killed, so that the coming king could not possibly take over.
Interesting detail. But this registration probably didn't happen the way that it's talked about here in the Gospel of Luke. So why is this in here this way?
Specifically talked about Emperor Augustus. Emperor Augustus is who? Does anyone know what Emperor Augustus' real name is? Caesar is a title.
Someone who wasn't at last service.
Octavian,
thank you. And Octavian was the emperor of the Roman Empire who did what? Unify. Or basically beat the other two people that were ruling in the Roman Empire and unify the Roman Empire.
He beat out the other two people that were also ruling in the Roman Empire
to unify the Roman Empire. He was known in the Roman Empire as the savior of the world. Under Emperor Augustus, Octavian, there was peace in the Roman Empire, and he was heralded in the empire as the savior of the world. So why is it that two rulers, Augustus and Quirinius, who probably didn't even notice the fact that a young girl had given birth that night in a manger in Bethlehem, were named in this story?
Probably has to do with that small little detail of the fact that the world thought that Emperor Augustus was their savior. And Luke was trying to inform them of the truth of the fact. But you're not going to find a savior out there. You need to look in the lowly estates of this manger, in the quiet and calm of that night, to find the real savior of the world. It's a little detail that sometimes gets overlooked.
And then, who are the first people that get to come and witness this
scene in this manger as the crowds are gathered for the census
that Augustus has brought to bring the Savior of the world into Bethlehem? The angels go to the shepherds out in the field, the stinky, smelly shepherds. Sorry if I just busted another bone. But think about it for a moment, really. What do shepherds do? They take care of sheep. Sheep are not the smartest animals in the world. And if you're out in the field 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, how often do you get to take a shower? Shower? What's a shower? Right. Really. So, I hate to even try to imagine what these shepherds, how dirty they were. And God sent the angels to them and said, I bring you good news of great joy, for unto you this day is born the King. Now, I want you to go home and clean up and put on the right kind of clothes and make yourself presentable before you go and pay homage to the baby. No, God did not say that. God said, go now. Leave the sheep, they'll be fine. Everything else will take care of itself. But he's being born right now. You need to go and see it.
And that's what God calls us to do each and every day of our lives. Drop everything and go as we are, stinky and smelly, unworthy to be a part of this scene, unworthy to be with Jesus in the manger, but to go and be with him there because God came to us to make it possible for us to go to God. For unto us this day is born in the city of David, a Savior of the whole world. Not any governor, not any ruler, not anything else in our lives that we think that can save us, but a baby born in a manger who will one day make his way to a cross because God loved us so much that he came to us. And that's the detail that we have to remember. in everything else that's going on in our lives and everything else that's happening in this dark time that we're living in with people getting killed, riots happening. And that's just our own country. It's not even talking about beyond our borders. All of the stuff that's going on in this world, that it seems so dark and foreboding. But as Isaiah reminds us that the light has come into the world. The great light shined in the darkness, that the darkness will never overcome. And that light has come to us this night. And it's come to bring us as we are, broken, bruised, and battered, ready to give up on life, to come to Him to worship Him in the manger. And then He'll take it from there and rebuild us from the ground up and make us to be into the people that He's called us to be and send us out into the world to show everyone the love that He's given us. So remember that detail. If everything else seems to fall apart around you and everything in Christmas is wrong and the family's just at each other's necks, stop. And remember that baby lying in a manger for you. Because God loves you so much that He sent His Son to bring you back to Him. So go out into all the world and tell them everywhere that you go that Jesus Christ, our Savior, is born.